181. That's Jesus' care. That's Jesus' care. Good morning, everyone. Happy Sabbath. Hope we've had a good week. I have had a busy week, really busy week. And this morning, I'm a little bit feeling overwhelmed because my only sister is undergoing a surgery this afternoon at 2 o'clock. So please, I ask your prayers and to pray for the family because we are feeling a little bit overwhelmed about it. But we know that God is in control. So bear with us and bear with me as well. But we thank God because I know that God is in control. So this morning, we are going to make use of hymn number 181, Does Jesus Care? I know he does. And you know, this song always reminds me of my mom. When I was coming in this country, that's the song that she was singing for me, that Jesus care, and he does care. So shall we all stand as we make use of hymn number 181?
Sing. Does Jesus care when my heart is bent too deeply for mirth and song? As the burdens press and the cares distress, as the ways feels weary and long. Oh yes, he cares. I know he cares, his heart is touched with my grief. When the days are dreary, the long nights weary, I know my Savior cares. Does Jesus care when my way is dark with a nameless dread and fear? As the daylight fades into deep night shades, does he cares enough to be near? Oh yes, he cares, I know he cares, his heart is touched with my grief. When the days are weary, the long nights dreary, I know my Savior cares. Does Jesus care when I've said goodbye to the dearest on earth for me? And my sad heart aches till it may. The days are weary, the long nights dreary, I know my Savior cares.
Oh God will help in ages past, I hope for years to come. Our kind and loving Father, again we come before you to give you thanks and praise. Father God, we thank you for life, for health, for strength. We thank you, Lord, for the movement of our bodies. Lord, you have kept us throughout this week, and it's our turn now to come to you to thank you, thank you, thank you for your loving care that you have given to each and every one of us. Father, bless the Sabbath school as we study your word, and may your word sink deep into our hearts that we will understand what to be said, what to be done, and it done the right way. Father God, remember those that are on their way here. We pray, dear Lord, that you will give them traveling mercies, clear the way that they get here in time to enjoy them, your loving words. Father, bless, guide, and protect those who are in hospitals, the nurses, the doctors, and each and every one that is suffering, dear Lord, remember them. In foreign land, what's happening, dear Lord, be with them and keep them all safe. Blessed joy, love, 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 my dear Jesus. Keep us safe and give us a beautiful Sabbath day. We pray in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. Shall we be seated? Does anyone know what today is all about? Well, the answer is saying, yes, he does. He's worshiping the Lord. Yes, yes, yes. That's very true. It's part of it. It's worshiping the Lord. But today, I think it's a special day as well. It's a very special day to the women. Today, it's Women's Day of Emphasis. And the theme of the day that we have is new beginnings. Your joy is coming. So we are talking about new beginnings. And when you have a new beginning, obviously you're going to have joy. So because we are looking at a bigger topic behind the new beginnings and the new joy, and we're talking about end it now. So we're talking about abuse, violence against women, which we are all aware about. So we are going to get into it as we go. So the theme for the day is new beginnings, your joy is coming. So can I hear everybody saying new beginnings? Your joy is coming. That's the theme of the day. So much as we are trying to look at that, we are going to get into our Sabbath school lesson, which is a very interesting one, and it says wise living. I don't know how much of us can testify and say that we are living wisely. I don't know how much we can claim about that. But when we look at how we are living, are we really living wisely? And if we are not, we are going to find out in the lesson. And the memory text is saying, look carefully then how you walk, not as unwise, but wise, making the best use of the time, because of the days are evil. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. So just by the memory text, I think we can ask ourselves many questions. Are we walking in the light of God? Are we making use or the best of the time that we have? And are we also understanding what the will of God is in our lives? So if we can ask ourselves these questions, I think it's more of last week. So it's like a personal reflection. How am I using my time? How am I walking in my walk as every day? Am I living to the best of my ability? So we are going to get deeper into the lesson as Sister Marcia is going to lead us through. So please, we ask you to participate. And those who are watching us online, welcome and feel free to participate and join as we get into the lesson. Thank you and God bless us all. We are now going to get into the lesson.
Good morning and happy Sabbath to everyone. Look at the beautiful sunshine. Let us see everyone smiling. Lovely day today. Lovely day. And as Sister Chinyama has just said, today is a special day, Women's Emphasis Day. And we hope that today we will be learning, and even if we're not learning anything new, that we can contribute to what the discussion is going to be throughout the day. Okay, so today, our lesson study, as our superintendent has already said, living wisely, living wisely. And I mean, everybody needs to be living wisely, everyone. And she's already read the memory verse, but I still want to go over it. Look carefully then how you walk. And as Christians, as members of this church, and for, as a matter of fact, every human being, this council should take this counsel. Look carefully then how you walk, not as unwise, but as wise, making the best use of the time, because the days are what? Evil. Therefore, do not be foolish. The days are evil. We are counseled not to be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. And the lesson, as we can see in this lesson, the question is, how can we live wisely? How do we get wisdom? As Christians, we look back at the discussions we have made in our lives, at the decisions that we have made in our lives. How many were influenced by the values of this world, and how many were influenced by God? Because sometimes when we make decisions, and we agree to do something, then we go to God and say, Lord, is this what we're doing here, the right thing? But we've already agreed, we've already made the decision. So the question is asked, do we remember to first, before we do anything, make that decision? Let us pray. Our kind and compassionate Father, which art in heaven, dear Lord, as we are about to study your word, to review some of the very important points that came out of the lesson this week, I pray your Holy Spirit may be in our midst. I pray, dear Lord, that we will leave this place with that resolution to be wise, to only seek you and your wisdom. Lord, I ask you to lead in everything that we do. May we do it to your honor and glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay. The next question was asked, do we pray and seek godly counsel before we make decisions? So this week we had that opportunity to go through this. And there's another text that I want to read relating to wisdom. But first of all, I'm going to be asking Sister Alsonia to do our first scripture reading, Ephesians 5, verses 15 to 17.
Ephesians chapter 5. Ephesians chapter 5, reading from verse 15 to 17. And it reads, see then that ye walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time, because the days are evil. Wherefore, be ye not unwise, but understanding what the will of the Lord is.
Amen. Thank you very much. And then there's another text which I just want to quickly put in. It says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your what? Own understanding. In all your ways, submit to him and he will make your path what? Straight. Do not be wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and shun evil. Another important, and that was found in Proverbs chapter 3, 5 to 6. The early Christians were in Ephesus were slipping back into the lifestyle that they had before they met Jesus. These were people who they had received the gospel, But for some reason, Paul heard that a lot of them were slipping back into the life, the old life that they had before. In his message to the Ephesians, Paul stressed that true wisdom does not come from the great philosophers of this world, those having a worldview where wisdom is based on values centered around human reason and abilities. Paul emphasized that to be wise is to know God's will for your life. If you that's the essence of being wise. Know God's will for your life, right? And to give him the opportunity, to give God, wisdom is giving God that opportunity to let the Holy Spirit live the life of Jesus in you. Okay, so let us have a look at Sunday's lesson, which the title was, Instead, Let There Be Thanksgiving. Instead, Let There Be Thanksgiving. What a title. Be imitators of God. And again, I'm going to ask you to read for me Ephesians 5, 1, to, 1 and 2, and Philippians 2 and verse 5. Sister Alsonia.
Ephesians chapter 5, verses 1 and 2. Be ye therefore followers of God as dear children, and walk in love as Christ also hath loved us, and hath given himself for us an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet smelling savor.
Philippians 2 and verse 5.
Philippians 2, verse 5. It says, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus.
Amen. Amen. So we want to focus on be imitators of God. So the question I want to ask you all, and please talk to, discuss it with, be sitting peers. If you're on your own, sit with someone and discuss this for a few seconds. What does it mean to be imitators of God? And what is, so it's two things I'm asking. What does it mean to be imitators? And also, what is walking in love, as the text brought out? And what motivates that? So let us first take the first part. What does it mean to be imitators of God? Let's do that. Let's do it in sections. Therefore, you don't get, by the time you finish talking, you forget what I asked after that. Yes. So talk to someone, please, and share what you understand about imitators of God. Please, sit with someone and share what you understand, and then we'll move on to this next part. Please sit with someone. Nobody should be on their own. If you want to sit in threes, it's okay. You don't have to sit in pairs, right? So if you're at home and you're viewing this, please, we are focusing on Ephesians 5, 1, verse 1 and 2. Okay. Be imitators of God. I'm going to ask us, because of time, we started a bit late. I'm going to stop you now. And can someone quickly share? Now, Sister Chinyama, I'm going to be asking someone now to share what they understand by be imitators of God. Anybody can share. Oh, there's a lady with her hand up.
Shall I speak now?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. I disagree with the word imitating. We don't imitate God. We are transformed by Christ.
Okay.
We are transformed into his character. False prophet imitates God.
This text.
We don't imitate. We look up to Christ. We take him as an example.
Mm-hmm.
And we ask him, we pray, by his grace, we are transformed into his character. So we become Christ-like. Imitating doesn't make us Christ-like.
Okay, would you like to answer that question? Can we get the mic to Anel?
Thanks so much. I want to say that I understand exactly what my sister is saying, and what she is describing is what the Bible has meant when it said be imitators of Christ. Sometimes with language, the meaning of words can transition over time.
Yes.
So this scripture is not trying to say that we should just pretend to be like Christ.
Mm-hmm.
What you described, following his example, taking it on, if you look at children, isn't that what they start to do? I've got some next door neighbors, mm-hmm. and you can hear them
mm-hmm.
copying their parents and their children.
Yeah.
But the more they copy as they mature,
yes.
those are going to become their values.
Yeah.
Do this, tidy up,
mm-hmm.
such and such.
Mm-hmm.
We're learning the ways of Christ, but we're supposed to let it go beyond skin and surface level. It's to become
who we are.
So that transformation is where we're going to. It's a journey.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, that's
okay. All right, we take one more on this, and then we'll move on.
It's to walk in the footsteps of Christ.
You're okay. Walking in the footsteps is imitating Christ, because Christ lives within us, and we are walking as the Spirit leads. Okay, thank you very much. All right. okay, now, walking in love. Paul used the verb to walk as a synonym for behavior or way of living. The question I wanted to ask was the second question, what motivates us? What is it that motivates us to want to walk like Jesus? Okay, again, you can just quickly speak with the person. Speak to the person quickly. You have a chance to talk to someone next to you about that. Share your views. Okay, what motivates? But this is very important, you know. When we think about wanting to serve the Lord, to be like him, of course we can't do that in our own strength. It's the Holy Spirit that works in us to do that. But then, because of the love, what we see, what motivates us? Who would like to answer that one? Yes, Elder Roy, please, go ahead.
So I would like to ask us, would we want to imitate somebody that we didn't love? And the answer obviously is no. Years ago when I was younger,
mm-hmm.
I used to admire a film star.
Okay.
And I was training to look like him. You know, so I lifted weight and all that sort of thing because I wanted to have a shoulder like Bodie. What's his name? The cowboy, Bodie.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody remembers him. Okay. So if I'm to admire God, then it must be something that I've seen in him.
Yes.
That I want to emulate in my own life, something I want to follow.
Uh-huh.
So obviously when we look at God and his character and so on, he showed it to Moses, isn't he?
Yes.
When he had him in the little shelter there and he passed by. And Moses saw all those beautiful characters of God. So these are the things, what we see and we love. We might not be able to measure up to it, but
yes.
we just see something
yes.
in someone and we want to follow
okay.
and imitate that individual.
Okay. Can we, yes, can you, did you have your hand up? Oh, sorry. Okay.
When I was a child,
yes,
my mother said, choose your friends.
Mm-hmm.
And if it loves God, Jesus, you choose to be with him all the time.
You made that choice.
All the time. So they said, the agape love, the
okay.
pure love.
So what you're saying then is that when you see Christ and what he has done, You have chosen him because of that.
Yes.
Is that what you're saying?
Yes, yes.
Okay, all right. Okay, we take from our sister there. And then we will move on. We want to look at
I see two reasons. One is because in him we see something we don't have.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Which is him. And also that looking ourselves, we see we desperately need a savior.
Amen. Amen. And that's it. When we think about what God has done, he sent his only begotten son to first he came as a baby and he lived a sinless life. He died and paid the price for our sins. He rose from the dead. He's now situated in heaven interceding on our behalf. So when we think about all the sacrifices that Jesus made on our behalf, that should draw us. Even that should have drawn us, you know, because of that love for him. All right. I want Sister Tracy to read for us Ephesians 5, 3 to 5, because we want to look a bit deeper now into, you know, what is going on. Why would we who have come out of darkness want to return to darkness? Can we read from Ephesians 5, 3 to 5?
Ephesians 5, verses 3 to 5. It reads, "But fornication and all uncleanness or covetousness, let it not be once named among you, as becometh saints. Neither filthiness nor foolish talking, nor jesting, which are not convenient, but rather giving of thanks. For this ye know, that no whoremonger, nor unclean person, nor covetous man, who is an idolater, had any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of God."
Amen. Thank you very much. So we hear what you've just read, there's so many different things listed here, that if we're partakers of these things, it's not we won't be able to enjoy it with our Savior in heaven. And of course, the question I want to ask is, in light of what is going on in our society today, now when we think about what Paul seen a similar thing happening to this group of people who he who he loved, who he knew, they've accepted the message, and now they're going back to where they were, the lifestyle that they used to live before they met him, which is of course not wise living. And he's saying here, Paul encouraged his readers to stay away from the sins of the flesh. Instead, give thanks to God. Now, what was he saying here? Because Paul is telling them to stay away from this, but instead, give thanks. Elder Peter Nathan, can you just, you know, give us some light on what do you think is happening here? What is Paul actually saying here?
When I was reading this and when I got your question, I said this is a big jump from talking about imitating God, walking in his full state with love, and straight away we jump into the sins of the flesh, trying to put the two together. But I managed to come to some sort of conclusion. If you want to understand the sins of the flesh, there's a long list in Galatians 5, 19 to 21. Mm-hmm. And that says that this particular sin of the flesh, Paul is talking about, he mentioned in the Galatian church. It wasn't just in the Ephesian church. And in verse 21, it says that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God, Paul was saying. And I said to myself, Paul must have seen enough for him to have this kind of business meeting with the Ephesian church. After he had spoken in Galatians of the same thing, sins of the flesh. And the King James Version used the word adultery and fornication. The NIV used sexual immorality.
Mm-hmm.
And I was thinking about that. I said, well, if it were just only about fornication and adultery, then it could be specific to either the so-called singles in the church or the married. But you can see that it was something that's going on among everybody, almost. And Paul wasn't happy with that. Because with these sins of the flesh, that stopped the work of the Holy Spirit, can bring people into the church. There was a preacher who said a young man came to church and went home. He didn't come back anymore. And when he was asked the reason why, he said because when he walked into the church, he couldn't see the difference between people in the church and him who is coming from outside. So he asked himself, so what's the point?
Mm.
Now, giving thanks, you that's where you wanted me to make much emphasis, is one, giving thanks to God. That telling us to turn away from mind-numbing use of wine and instead experience together the presence and power of the Spirit. And another point I picked up there, giving thanks to God, instead of staying in this sin of the flesh, Paul says, ban drunkenness, which is also against the use of alcohol. And then if you're struggling and having a problem about what alcohol can do, please read Proverbs chapter 23, verses 29 to 35.
Mm-hmm.
Paul is saying, giving thanks to God instead of staying in the sins of the flesh. He said, the evil things that come in the wake of drunkenness include crude, mm-hmm. sexually explicit speech, manlessness, immorality, and adultery. These are to be exchanged for thoughtful, spirit-inspired worship of God.
Mm-hmm.
Paul saying, giving thanks means speaking spiritual words, singing and making melody, submitting ourselves to God. Giving thanks to God, Paul says here, it applies the exhortation to be filled with the Spirit. Cooperating. Imagine believers gathering in spirit-inspired worship of God that nourishes unity.
Oh.
And the final points I have here say, mm-hmm. giving thanks means Christian worship, where musical praise dominates, spiritual songs dominate.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Let's hear what you have to say. Can we get the mic to Elder Anel?
Thank you for the response. Thank you for the response, Elder Nathan. All I wanted to add is just something more on why giving thanks to God helps to keep us away from the works of the flesh.
Right.
First of all, and I'm glad to see our praise and worship, our music leader here, and we know what it's like, that when you have a good experience of worshiping God,
mm-hmm.
it lifts your heart, your mind heavenward.
Mm-hmm.
Even things that were harassing you,
mm-hmm.
your mindset
mm-hmm.
shifts.
Mm-hmm.
We hear that God inhabits mm-hmm. praise.
Mm-hmm.
So if God is filling us, his thoughts, his ways,
mm-hmm.
the things of the flesh lose their significance. We've all heard the song, turn your eyes on Jesus,
yes.
look full in his wonderful
mm-hmm.
face, and the things of earth grow
mm-hmm.
strangely dim. Also, when we take time to give thanks to God, our minds will be like Joseph. You recognize all that God has done for you, and then the futility and folly of sin becomes
mm-hmm.
more magnified, and the likelihood of us falling into it,
mm-hmm.
thinking, God, I don't have, but I don't have, so I'm going to do. When you say, but look at what God has given me, how can I dishonor him?
Mm-hmm. And that is a very important point. Sometimes when we're in our, we feel down because we don't have things that other people have. Sometimes when we start looking at what other people have, it brings us out of a covetousness, a sort of a dissatisfaction that I don't have what that person has, and then you just feel, you don't feel good about yourself. And it's at those moments you can slip into getting involved with the sins of the flesh. Because sometimes you say, okay, let's go and watch something on telly that's going to make me feel good. Let me just go and eat something that's going to make me feel good. Let me just go to this place and that's going to let me feel good. Let me just read this novel that's going to let me feel good. So we have to, when we find ourselves, the sins around us are trying, as you said, let us give thanks and praise for what God has done. The time when we have overcome our temptations. So we use the praise, as you said, to lift our spirits. You know, when we feel down, I've experienced that so many times. When I feel down and I get turn on my music and I start to sing, you know, I'm praising God, it brings down the depression or the anything that was trying to take over. It brings it down. I say, praise be to God, and I feel good again. I can get up and go. So it's very important that we praise God. We give him thanks for the things that he has done in spite of what is trying to come our way. Yes, please. Yes, let's wait for the mic. Wait for the mic, Sister Richardson. Yes. That's right. Amen. Okay, let's look at walking as children of light. Walking as children of light. We like Sister... She's not here. Okay, you're going to read it for us. Sister Tracy is going to read Ephesians 5, 8 to 10.
Ephesians 5, verse 8 to 10 reads, "For he was sometimes darkness, but now are ye light in the Lord. Walk as children of light, for the fruit of the Spirit in all goodness and righteousness and truth, proving what is acceptable unto the Lord."
Okay, thank you very much. What it says, but now you are light, for you were once in darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Live as children of light, right? Again, we can't overemphasize the fact that, remember, Paul is talking to people who knew God, who accepted Christ as their personal Savior, but for whatever reason, they started to slip. Now we know that they were in a place where we have all these, as the lesson's going to bring up, all these different people who come with their ideologies and want to share. We see it in our world today. People will want to tell us how we should run our lives. People will tell us to go against what the Bible teaches because they think that their philosophy is greater than the philosophy of God. So Paul is saying, listen, you are people of light. Don't allow yourself to slip. You are people of light. Now, the question I want you to ask, how do we know if we are walking in the light? We come to church. Somebody said to me once, I don't even know if I'm saved, to be honest. And I'm saying, why did you say you don't know if you're saved? Because I don't feel like I'm saved. I'm saying, well, look at your lifestyle. Compare your lifestyle to what the Bible is teaching, and use that as a kind of a measure. So I'm asking the question, how do we know, if you're giving counsel to someone, how do we know if we are walking in the light? Sit with someone and have that discussion. How do you know? Somebody asked you that question, or you might need to ask somebody that question. You can sit in threes, you can sit in twos, but let nobody just sit there, don't have someone to discuss with. Okay, I'm now going to ask one or two people to share. how would you counsel someone to say, if they ask that question, how do I know that I am walking in the light? How do I know? I would like please get the mic to Sister Carter.
We know that we are walking in the light according to what the Bible says, we have the fruit of the Spirit.
Right.
Love, joy, peace, long suffering, gentleness. And even when we are being annoyed, the Bible says, be angry and sin not, but yet you will have a pleasant disposition and how you react in the words you say.
Okay. Somebody else, please. Okay, we have Elder Palmer.
Well, it talks about being in darkness, and we know what it's like being in, when we walk in darkness.
Yes.
Our desire is to do that which is of the world.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? We want to fulfill the lust of flesh, pride of life. But when we become part of the light, we no longer have any desire for that which is of the darkness. We have no desire to do the things of unrighteousness. Our desire is to please the Lord. So yeah. we find ourselves by the Holy Spirit prompting. Our whole heart is wrapped up in doing that which the Holy Spirit wants us to do.
Okay.
So when we sin, we immediately recognize, oh, I've done something that is wrong here. I've sinned against God, and we seek His forgiveness.
Yes.
And our desire is to recommit our relationship with
Okay.
So that we can continue to walk in
it. Yes. So when we're walking in the light, we are not, people who are walking in the light, not necessarily, yes, you can fall. Because the Bible says that, you know, if we sin, we what? We have an advocate who is faithful and just to what? Forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. We are not habitual sinners. So when you make a mistake, you get, as you said, we confess our sins and we move. We have the Word of God to use as a guide as to what it looks like, because we have been given the revelation of Jesus Christ, and the revelation is the light. That revelation is the light that takes us through the world. Elder Roy, I'm gonna. Is that Elder Roy who I did say? Oh. Yes? And then we have also Brother Newell.
It's when people see Christ in us.
Yes.
That we know that we reflect Christ. So we have the light in us.
Okay.
He's the light.
All right. So somebody, but do you think that you might be always in a place where confirm to you that you are walking in the light? They will come and say, oh, I can see in your life that you are walking. Do we always find ourselves in those situations?
But Jesus said, follow me. So if he is the light, so we follow him.
Yes.
We are in the light.
Yes, okay. Any, yes, Elder Roy?
And light is to the world. So in other words, to the people of the world, just like salt is, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
So it's those two elements, the light and the salt. But the light must be something that we can do for other people, something that they're going to see in us.
Yes.
Therefore, people will always come to us if we have the light.
Yes.
And we can give them good advice.
Okay.
We can show them the way to go in all circumstances.
Okay, thank you very much.
Then by doing that, we are reflecting the light from God.
That's right. Okay. Elder Brother Newell.
When you walk in darkness, you can't see where you're going.
Mm-hmm.
You stumble, you even fall.
Yes.
But when you are in the light, you see where you're going, and then you're able to walk straight and not stumble.
Okay.
So Jesus said in Matthew, we are the light of the world.
Yes.
We are like a city certainly another day.
Yes.
So when we have the light, we should walk
in the light. And Jesus himself also said, okay, let's take one more, and then we will... Did you want to say something, Sister Tracy?
Sister Romeo.
Oh, okay. Yes, Sister Romeo.
No, there's a big difference between two simple words in the English language.
Yes.
Ah. And the. When you ah, you say walking in a light.
Mm-hmm.
Completely different to walking in the light. I mean, okay. When you go to school in Salem, near Marshall, you have distinguishing adjectives and whatever, and we don't understand how important the word
the article.
Is. If you say a man came mm-hmm. in here, it could be anybody, but when you can point your finger and say the man, it's a completely different meaning. So if you're walking in a light. I mean, some of them, when I was coming through the door this morning, I said, Lord, why am I coming to church? What am I going to get out of it? What do I have to give? You know, in my soul. And well, the light is the guide. What would Jesus do? He mm-hmm. is the light.
He is the light.
What would Jesus do in such a circumstance or what of you? Because there are lots of other lights around. A light. You could think you're seeing right and what of you, but it's a light. That's my humble contribution.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Okay. All right. So I want to move on. I just wanted to say this, that Jesus himself said that I am the vine, you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Right? So when we're thinking about this light, we have to abide. Because when we start moving around and get ourselves out of, you know, start getting ourselves involved with other things, we fall back into darkness. And this is what Paul was saying to these people. You know, true wisdom is about your connection to Christ. So don't go back to the lifestyle of these philosophers in the world who are going to tell you what you can do to, you know, to get the ultimate enjoyment. Okay, let's move on. How can we, let's read, we have Sister Elder Anel. I would like you to read for me Ephesians 5, 6 and 7, please.
Ephesians 5, verses 6 and 7. Read with me, people viewing online. Let no man deceive you with vain words. I must say, as a woman, I feel this personally, but it applies to men too. Let no woman deceive you with vain words.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Where's my, yes. For because of these things cometh the wrath of God mm-hmm. upon the children of disobedience. Be not ye therefore partakers with them.
Mm-hmm.
I think this is it. You said 5
yes.
to 7.
Yes.
Did I start from verse 6? Sorry. For this ye know, that no whoremonger, nor unclean person, nor covetous man, who is an idolater, hath any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of God. Let no man or woman mm-hmm. deceive you with vain words.
Yes.
For because of these things cometh the wrath of God upon mm-hmm. the children of disobedience.
Yes.
Be not ye partakers with them.
Okay, so, and this is a very important part. We are wise people. Who, when we are grounded in Christ, we are wise. But as the lesson is showing us, even when we think we are grounded, we can become deceived by what is happening in the world. And we take it on, and we want to bring it inside the church. So, Elder Roy, can you please address this question? It says here, how can we become deceived by those with empty words? How is God's wrath different from the wrath of man? Can you please address that?
When I read in the Psalms, the voice of the Lord breaks the cedar of Lebanon.
Mm-hmm.
It caused the hind to calve. You know, it makes the mountain skip like a ram or like a calf and so forth. And God is not even angry yet, right? So if we, for instance, should consider the wrath of human being, it is very limited.
Yes.
Because if justice is to be done to us, say, in court, the judge might only understand a little bit about the individual's case. But when it comes to God, he understands even
the motives
of our minds.
Yes.
He knows everything.
And all our motives. That's right.
So therefore, if it comes to a place where God is wrath with us, then it's a very serious place to be in.
Yes.
Even the thought of it.
Yes.
Because often when we get justice or things are meted out to us, it's the very thought of our wrongs.
Yes.
That's
yes.
going to affect us.
Okay.
And David himself, realizing who God is, that whatever he does is mixed with mercy
and love
and justice.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore, there is no limitation to if God gets angry with you. So Paul is saying, listen, stay on the right side of God so that you don't experience his wrath, because his wrath would have been thorough and it's poured out without mixture.
Okay. Oh, can we? All right. Elder Annette, can you, when in your answer, address also the empty words? What does it mean? Can we get a mic to Elder Annette? What does it mean, you know, to not to be deceived by those who only have empty words?
We can see a direct link. Do you know that people can talk you out of a good position and cause you to do foolish things when you were on the right track?
Yes.
I've seen it. You know, I remember 1 year going, I think we were in our 20s, I went with my friend to Jamaica. And some of the guys who were there operating on the beach and so on, their big thing is obviously they're looking for women who are either gonna financially support them, sadly it happens, or who they can enjoy themselves with for the time. And one of the things they used to do was to try and get in your brain, I'm going to get you, you know, before you leave this place, this is going to happen. And they start to introduce ideas. In fact, sometimes when people want to tempt you into inappropriate things, it starts with a joke. I remember going on a legal shadowing once, and two men who knew better shared with me the most inappropriate joke as somebody who was volunteering. And I know that they were just trying to check me out to see if they could cross those boundaries. And obviously I'm not gonna wanna insult them because I'm looking work opportunities, but I know they could pick up from the expression I wasn't going there. So don't entertain, because what you start off doing is laughter, and of course, a certain jesting, it can be intriguing, can't it?
Yeah.
Not just for sexual things, but for other things that are not appropriate. But the concepts that they start to introduce, they can wear down your spiritual barriers. And humor. In fact, if you look at society, and if you look at the position we're in now, do you know that often it was in comedies that some of these concepts were introduced? Those individuals, and I hope you know what I'm talking about, they were the laughing stock. They were just to laugh at because they were different. And before you know it, they're running the society. They're trying to influence how we do school. So humor can be a very powerful thing to wear down your defenses and cause us to entertain sin. And that's why God is saying, don't laugh with them. Mm-hmm. Don't entertain those idle words, because words, they can be to life or to death.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. I think we have to move on.
Wants to contribute.
Okay. Yes, it's Kato. And then we're going to have to move on.
My contribution is that we have to know the true word. The Bible says that thy word is a lamp
unto
my feet
and a light.
And a light unto my path.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm just getting up to emphasize that we need to dig into the word
Anoint.
Of God, because he is the word. And when you have that genuine word,
yes,
you will be able to pick up the emptiness
right
of other words.
Thank you very much. Now, I just want to quickly move on because this is a very important point. We're looking at, we've seen the light of God exposed. Awake, O sleeper. I just want to pick something from there and also link that with the redeeming of the time. Now, can we have Carol, did she, yes, reading for us Ephesians 5, 11 to 14.
And it says, have nothing to do with the fruitless deeds of darkness.
Please stand. Go ahead.
Have nothing to do with the fruitless deeds of darkness, but rather expose them. It is shameful even to mention what the disobedient do in secret. But everything exposed by the light becomes visible, and everything that is illuminated becomes a light. That is why it is said, wake up, sleeper, rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you.
Amen, amen. So here Paul is saying to these people, listen, you're in a position now where you can lose out completely. You're sleeping, wake up. Because, you know, I mean, for us, he could have said, we don't know when Christ is coming. We need to get the light out there to everyone. So now we see he's talking about they are to wake up. Now the question I wanted to ask, what should motivate us to expose the unfruitful works of darkness? How do we expose them? I'm going to ask Elder Palmer to say something about this because, you know, as a church, we are called to take the three angels' message to the world. A lot of things are going on in the world today. And, you know, Paul wanted to expose what was going on, to let people see, you know, what was happening and let the light shine. And of course, light will always shine, and when there's light, darkness will have to dispel itself. Okay, go ahead, please, Elder.
Yes, when we walk in darkness, we're unable to see. I remember a couple of years ago, we went on a camping trip. We went on a hike overnight, and the day before, rain fell, and when we were going through the hike, there was one section of the hike where suddenly some of the children decided they didn't want to follow the path where the person was leading us with the light. They wanted to go a different route, and as they traveled through that route, they ended up getting stuck. When we finally shined the light in where they were, they were in a swampy area. Many of them lost their shoes. We spent quite a lot of time trying to find their shoes because they got lost. Light reveals.
Mm-hmm.
Light is revelation. When Jesus came into this world, he came to reveal the darkness.
Yes.
To show us that in darkness there is destruction, there is despair.
Mm-hmm.
When we are out of darkness and coming to the light, we are now in a better position to see our brothers and our sisters are following the pathway of destruction.
Mm-hmm.
And out of love, it should be our intention to expose darkness.
Yes.
Jesus came into this world. He said, for God so loved the world that he gave his
only begotten Son.
And whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life.
Yes.
It was out of love that Christ came to expose darkness and to expose wickedness so that people in the world can be saved, be attracted to the world, attracted to him, and come away from destruction, darkness, and despair.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you very much. Okay, I want us to look at what it means to read. So I'm going to ask Sister Tracy, just quickly read for us Ephesians 5, 15 and 17. And then the question is going to be asked, what does it mean to redeem the time? And I'm going to ask Elder Nathan just to quickly wrap that up for us. Yes.
Ephesians 5, verse 15 to 17 reads, "See then that ye walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time, because the days are evil." 17 says, "Wherefore be ye not unwise, but understanding what the will of the Lord is."
Amen. Now, Elder Peter, time is against us here, but I'm asking if you could just wrap up and explain that phrase that we need to take on board.
Yes, redeeming the time refers to stewarding our time in a way that glorifies God.
Mm-hmm.
Because each one of us here has a limited amount of time on this earth.
Yes.
And another meaning of that is that we should be careful in how we live.
Yes.
And the third one that I picked up from the lesson says, redeeming the time, making the best use of the time.
Mm-hmm.
We did in great time. God gave it to us. And because we can't live forever now, we have to make good use of that time. What impact, that's the most important, what impact should it have on us?
Yes.
I picked up just a few points here. One, for us, is to look carefully into our spiritual walk with God.
Yes.
Not to be foolish, not to be unwise, but be wise.
Yes.
The second point I have says to understand what the will of the Lord is. We have been saying that. And we know that the will of God is for us to do what he has asked us to do so that we can inherit the kingdom when it comes. The third point I have here, to snap up the bargains, which is the title of that lesson, really. Our lesson says that as we await Christ's return, we have to snap up the bargain.
Mm-hmm.
And most of us like bargain, even when we go on holiday. When we buy one and get so many free, we flood into it. Now we have the bargain, let us snap it up. The next point I have, to understand and accept the moment of opportunity,
mm-hmm.
which is the salvation offered to us in Christ Jesus.
That's right.
And the last point I have says, we must know that this phrase,
mm-hmm.
redeeming the time, is also a challenging time because the days are evil.
Yes.
I like the way I may touch on so many things.
Mm-hmm.
As we wait for Christ's return, we must know that the day is evil.
Yes.
We must remember that we live in a very difficult time. We can't forget that.
Yes.
And we can only say, may God help us. It's a challenging time, it's a challenging life, it's a challenging world. But may God help us to snap up the time and know that our time here is very short.
Yeah, it's very short. And sometimes we waste so much time when we could use that time to educate ourselves in the Word, to help others. We spend so much time selfishly on ourselves. Not that God doesn't want us to invest in ourselves, but we need to redeem the time, recognize that we need to help others to know what is happening before the end of time. Okay, we're going to look at now Spirit-filled worship. Spirit-filled worship. And we just quickly have to pass through this because the text, I don't have it here, but I'm going to ask, quickly, Tracy, just quickly sort of go through what Ephesians 5:18 is saying about worship. Can we get the sound in this mic, please?
Wherein in excess, but be filled with the Spirit.
Mm-hmm.
Speaking to yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord, giving thanks always for all things unto God and the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen. Amen. So, what's the advice to the church? How are we going to overcome this problem? You know, we're getting drunk in all of what is going on in the world. We're coming to church. We're falling back into the sins of where we were at the beginning. No crisis who has brought us out. We don't want to go back there. So, how should the church focus on worship? Who would like to have something to say here? We're looking at worship.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Looking at worship. Worship should be an experience between you and God. When you come into the house of God, we must experience the presence of God through our worship. There are certain type of worship should never be in our churches. They are church, they are worship. When we worship the Lord, we must worship in spirit and in truth. Mm-hmm. And God says when we come to worship him,
yes,
we must worship him as he wants us to worship. Because when we worship to him and not to ourselves.
Okay.
And when
one more point.
Yes, sir.
Go ahead.
And when we worship, we must give God the glory. Because giving him the glory, we must say thank you, Jesus, for what he has done.
Mm-hmm.
Because when we worship as us, some of us as singers, as musicians, we must sing to the praise and glory of God.
Mm-hmm.
Because when we sing, we must sing to praise his name and give him the glory.
Amen.
And not to ourselves, because there's a message in every song we sing. And when we sing, we must sing to the honor of his name.
Okay, thank you, Joseph. Thank you very much. And I must want to add that we must also remember that our worship is not just about the singing. It's how we think as well, our mindset when we come through. Are we here to share our worship with others? To lift other people when we come into church? Is our face so long that people are afraid to say Happy Sabbath to us? Is our whole attitude when we come to church, how we deal with each other? Can we say good morning instead of passing people? You know, so it's all of that. I have to stop now, so I'm gonna come to an end by saying the lesson. It emphasized three major themes. Christian wisdom is rooted in God's revelation or Christ's light. Two, Christian wisdom is not a collection of witty statements about life. Rather, it is a lifestyle, a walk of life transformed by the Holy Spirit according to the pattern left to us by Christ. And finally, Christian wisdom is about salvation and worship. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Sister Masia. We are running behind time. I know that we had a few hands up, but sorry, bear with us, because we're running behind time. So we want to thank everyone who participated in our Sabbath School lesson. And it's nice when we all participate, because it makes us understand the lesson deeper. Some questions that you might have by yourself at home, when we come together, we share and we explore and we learn to see that God has a way that he helps us to do many things. So we want to thank everyone online who are participating and watching, and we pray that next Sabbath you will come and worship with us. So we'll go into our mission spotlight. As we do that, we are going to ask our deacons to collect the offering for us. So before we collect the offering, shall we have a word of prayer? Shall we pray? Father in heaven, we thank you this morning for your grace and for your mercy and for bringing us to your place of worship. We pray that as we give your offering unto thee to do thy work in missions and different places, we ask you to bless this offering and bless the hands that are going to give, that you will bless them abundantly and fill these holes where they will take these monies out. In Jesus' name I pray, thanksgiving in my heart. Amen. So we're going to have the mission spotlight as the offering is being collected.
Ellen White wrote, "Those who love God should feel deeply interested in the children and youth. To them, God can reveal his truth and salvation." Realizing the importance of reaching the young in their community, church members in cities around the world are connecting with this special group in different ways. Let's look at some of the largest urban areas of the United States, where Adventists are ministering to youth and children. Los Angeles, California is the second largest city in the country. In the greater Los Angeles area, members of a Vietnamese Seventh-day Adventist church saw the need to teach younger generations how to speak Vietnamese so that they could communicate with their older non-English speaking family members. The church opened the first Vietnamese language school in the city. The children not only learn the language, but also become more familiar with their culture. What began as weekly classes became a summer camp and then an after-school program. Opening the language school enabled the church members to fill a need in the community and to serve the people in the city. Chicago, Illinois is the third largest city in the U.S. In Chicago, staff at an urban center of influence called Art Space use pottery, crafts, painting, and music to connect with children. Located next to a play area in a busy mall, the center initiates relationship building through creative activities. Art Space is open throughout the week, and it partners with different groups, such as schools, to make its activities available to children. The center's goal is to make the community aware that the center is present to provide a blessing to people in the surrounding areas. Are you inspired to do your part in reaching a particular group in your city? There are the university students, the deaf, the young parents, the caregivers, all who can benefit from your interaction with them. Visit missiontothecities.org for resources and more ideas on how you can use your skills and talents to reach the people in your city.
Okay, so we all have talents that we can use and reach out to many people, and sometimes we can just interpret in a language that somebody else will understand what we're doing. So God is good. So we've come to the end of our Sabbath school, and thank you everyone who came on time. We're going to stand up and make use of hymn number 430 as we come to the close of our Sabbath school. And yes, please. Shall we all stand, please, and make use of that hymn?
Just pray. Father, we thank you for the opportunity that we can come here once again. And we thank you for tabernacling with us in our Sabbath school today. We thank you also to give us the opportunity wherein we can come and share our ideas and our thoughts from what we have gleaned from the lesson study. We pray, dear Lord, that you please to help us to feed upon your words and to help others and to tell them about your great love. Help us to never forget the great sacrifice that you have made for us to share in your heavenly kingdom. We ask now that you please to bless everyone that gather here today. These mercies we pray in your precious name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Shall we be seated, please? Thank you. Shall we all be seated? We'd like to thank you all for coming, and we want to praise the Lord for the good things that he has done. And we still have the theme of the day. I know some of you came late. The theme of the day is new beginnings, because joy is coming. So if you've had some bad life, trust me, it's a new beginning today. And trust me, you have joy. If you asked me to sing that song that we sang in my language, in my tongue, oh my gosh, you would have seen me singing, blowing this rooftop. But don't worry, one day I'll sing it in my language. So thank you all for participating. And please, I still ask for your prayers. As I said earlier on to those that came late, my sister is undergoing surgery this afternoon. So every one of us in the family, we're a little bit overwhelmed with it, but we know that God is in control. So we are praying for her. And I know that God sometimes does things in a way that we can't understand, but he's always faithful. So pray for us. And also, this week, on Friday, it's my birthday. So please, just pray for me that God leads me into those new chapters of life. So thank you for coming on, and thank you for participating as we ask Sister Krisha to come and do the personal ministries spotlight. And those going into the divine service, please go into the vestry because we're running behind time. Thank you.
Happy Sabbath, Holloway Church. Happy Sabbath. I'm looking at the time. So welcome to the personal ministries evangelism slot. I'm going to keep it extremely brief. And I'm simply going to say to you that church, in line with the words of Matthew chapter 28, verse 19, we are desperate for help on Wednesdays in the cafe with the food distribution. We are desperate for help on Sabbath afternoons to go out and share leaflets. Not only are we desperate, but we desire your company and your presence. We desire your input. We desire your influence. We desire the use of the gifts that God has given you as part of our outreach. And so if there is something that you can do to help, if you hear the Holy Spirit speaking to your heart, please come and see me or our dear Sister Gladys. Give a wave, Sister Gladys. And we will talk about that. May God bless you as you minister. Let us briefly pray together. Our loving Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you again for the blessings the Sabbath has to offer. We thank you, O God, for granting us with life and a measure of health and strength. We thank you, O God, for giving us gifts. We thank you for your Holy Spirit, O Lord God, and we pray that our love for you will so swell in our hearts, O Lord, that we will not help but have to go and spread the good news so that the kingdom of God may be hastened and you will come. This is my humble prayer, our humble prayer, with thanksgiving. In Jesus' mighty name, amen.
Happy Sabbath, Church. I'm Natalie Nakor, and I'd like to offer a warm welcome to our Sabbath service. Whether you are worshipping with us in person or online, I pray that you'll be truly blessed today in Jesus' name. I'd like to run through some general housekeeping points with you, particularly if you are worshipping with us in person for the first time. The toilets are situated in the corners of the inner foyer near the entrance to the church. The emergency exits with clear signs are at the rear and front of the church. There are no plans for a fire drill today, so if you hear the alarm, please make your way quickly and in an orderly fashion through the exits and meet in front of the building to the left for further instructions. I'd like to also remind all parents to please be mindful of your children's whereabouts while in church and ensure that they behave respectfully throughout. Here are some further announcements for your attention. Sister Joyce Richardson and the entire family would like to express immense appreciation for all the love and support before, during, and after the funeral of her dear daughter, Dawn Richardson. May the Lord truly bless you all as we keep each other in prayer. This is a reminder that the SEC Sabbath School Department invites all Sabbath School leaders and teachers to attend the Macon Sabbath School Alive in My Church online training session tomorrow from 10:30 a.m. to 3:30 p.m. The speakers for this event are Pastor Fergus Osei Boateng and Pastor Juan Carlos Patrick. This event will take place on Zoom. Tune in by keying in ID 916-780-31198 and passcode 2021. All those travelling via coach to Clacton-on-Sea on Bank Holiday Monday the 28th, please note that you will need to be here at Holloway by 8:30 a.m. at the very latest. Please adhere to this time to avoid any disappointments. This is a reminder that the 64th SCC session will be taking place from the 7th to the 10th of September. If you are interested to learn more about why these sessions are held and what they entail, please visit the SEC session website at sec.adventist.uk/SEC Session 2023/. Here you will be able to access the session reports, including reports from the various departments of the conference, detailing the work and highlights over the past 4 years. You may read these reports in advance or follow along at the time of the conference session. And finally, the SDA Generation X program, Something to Shout About, will be taking place on Friday the 1st and Sabbath the 2nd of September at the Broadway Theatre in Catford, SE6. The weekend promises to be filled with uplifting music, meaningful messages, and an overall spirit-filled experience. Tickets are sold out, however, for those with tickets, the Holloway minibus will be available on both days to transport you there. So if you wish to travel on the minibus, please place your name on the list on the notice board as soon as possible. This brings me to the end of today's announcements. Don't forget, you can catch today's and our previous services on our YouTube channel. Simply search Holloway SDA Church. Thank you for listening. I'm Natalie Nicole. Stay blessed and have a wonderful Sabbath. Happy Sabbath, Church. I'm Natalie Nicole, and I'd like to offer a warm welcome to our Sabbath service.
I just want to add to our announcements from Holloway, and then you'll have the Andy Roberts. I was asked to say a few words from the Richardsons, but I saw it on the announcement, so I won't go into that. But just to let you know that Peggy is now transferred from the London Hospital to the Homerton Hospital, and I can say that she is making progress. She was transferred there yesterday, and she is in Graham Ward in the Homerton Hospital. Visitors are allowed, and as usual, two to a bed. Let us continue praying for her and all others that are at home recovering, etc. Sister Batiste is still in hospital. So let us remember our members. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.
I'm done. Sean Roberts, bringing you SEC News in 60 seconds. The SEC's Extreme Teens Camp at Cornwall's Chapel Porth campsite concluded last Sunday, August 20th. 85 campers explored the theme Bended But Not Broken through discussions and devotionals led by speakers including SEC Pathfinder Director Pastor Clifford Herman. They also participated in outdoor activities such as kayaking, go-karting, rock climbing and zip lining. Last Sabbath, during the BUC Youth Day of Fellowship at Bethel Convention Centre, Birmingham, five SEC youth leaders were among nine across the UK to be recognised for completing Senior Youth Leadership Award training. The presentation was officiated by SEC Youth Director, Pastor Anthony Fuller. Sydenham Church reported it hosted a health expo. It featured presentations on the eight laws of health and offered members of the community health checks and one-to-one consultations with healthcare professionals. Thanks for watching. See you next week. Read these stories in full at our website, sec.adventist.uk. And don't forget to like and subscribe to our social media platforms to get the latest videos from the SEC.
Good morning, church. Can we stand and sing the introit, Welcome in This Place? Again, welcome in this place. Welcome in this place. We offer you the highest praise.
I was glad when they said unto me, Let us go into the house of the Lord. Are we glad to be in the house of the Lord this morning? Yes. Amen. O come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Jehovah, our Maker, for he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. At this time, we are going to have our opening prayer. For those of us who can we kneel for prayer? For those of us who can't, remain standing, please, and bow your heads. Lord, we thank you for this, your holy Sabbath day. We thank you for bringing us here together to worship your holy and matchless name. We pray a blessing upon the proceedings that will take place shortly. We pray that all who are in the hearing of my voice will receive the blessing that you have in store for us on this your blessed day. I pray that you'll be with those who are on their way, and I pray that at the end of the day, we can say it was good for us to be in the house of the Lord. These and other mercies I ask in the mighty name of Jesus, amen. Please be seated. I would like to welcome you all to this Women's Ministries Day. It's so good to see so many of you out, even though we've got a few blue seats, but it's good to see those of us who are here, and lots of us have smiles on our faces. For those who don't have a smile on your face, I pray that by the end of today's service, you will have a smile on your face. I want to welcome those who are worshiping with us online. I pray that we will all receive the blessing that God has in store for us. Welcome.
Can we stand and sing the opening hymn, Faith is the Victory, number 608. 608, Faith is the Victory. I have you doing squats, church.
Christian soldiers ride and press the
every hand.
On every hand the foe.
Drawn up in dread array. Let tents of ease be left behind and onward to the fray. Salvation's helmet on each head, with truth all girt about. The earth shall tremble neath our tread and echo with our shout. Overcomes the foe.
Overcomes the foe. White raiment shall be given. Before the angels he shall know his name confessed in heaven. Then onward from the hills of light, our hearts with love aflame will vanquish all the hosts of night.
Happy Sabbath, Church. It's time for the tithes and offering. So as the deacons prepare, I'll just have a short reading. Give and it will be given to you. A good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over will be poured into your lap. And that's from Luke 6:38. Gloria and Enoch embarked on their long-awaited vacation. The plan was to spend a couple of days visiting their son's family and their three granddaughters, and then go to their favorite beach on the coast to enjoy the sun and the water. That Sabbath, as they attended church with their granddaughters, the pastor made a special offering appeal to those in attendance to cover the expense of replacing the church roof. Gloria and Enoch felt impressed to give all the money they had saved for their beach vacation to the church for the new roof and to spend the rest of their vacation with their son's family instead. To their surprise, when they returned home, Gloria found a letter in the mail from her work at the hospital stating that they had miscalculated her wages and needed to pay her back some wages. Enclosed was a check for exactly double the amount that her and Enoch had gave to the Adventist church to help with the roof. The Bible promises that when you give, it will be given back to you. So I want to encourage you to be faithful in returning your tithe and your freewill offering. Let's bow our heads for prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for such a wonderful Sabbath day. Thank you for the blessings that you give to us so freely, and thank you for the opportunity to be able to give back to you. Lord, I pray as the tithes and offerings are collected that you bless them and that they go to further your work. Please bless those that were able to give and those that weren't able to give. And please continue to bless us. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Good morning, church, and pleasant Sabbath. I'm going to do a spoken word piece this morning. It's based on our End It Now campaign. Once upon a time, in a church called Holloway, a young woman visited for Family Life Day. She sat and she listened. She listened and she sat, but words went in one ear and through the other flew right out back. For though she sat physically in the church, in the pew, her mind was somewhere else that only she knew. Drifting memories from her past arose, like the smell of cigarette embedded in her nose. The sound of Amazing Grace at full volume mutes her mother's screams as her father beats her in another room. A man of God, when he's not at home, but a beast when his true colors are shown. She remembered running, crying, hiding away. How many times to this same God did she have to pray? Her mother too caught up in her love for her husband left this young woman alone. She had no one. Anyone. But met the wrong one. Now she's running from all the things that she's done. When she looks inside, she doesn't like what she sees, and the tears just keep falling every time she falls asleep. No way out. Where could she run? Until she heard the voice of the right one. You fell asleep to the moon? I'm here to greet you with the sun. I could feel your heartache and your pain. Jesus says, come to me. You'll never be the same. Let me in the wall you feel around. I'm the light to a match that can burn it to the ground. I could feel your heartache and your pain. Jesus says, come to me, you'll never be the same. Let me air the wall you feel around. I'm the light to a match that can burn it to the ground. He can feel your heartache and your pain. Jesus says, come to him, you'll never be the same. Let him in the wall you feel around. He's a light to a match that can burn it to the ground. He can feel your heartache and your pain. Jesus says, come to him, you'll never be the same. Let him in the walls you built around. He's a light to a match that can burn it to the ground.
It's now time. It's now time for the intercessory prayer. So before we pray, we will sing the song, "You Are My Strength." Again, let's hear you, church. Reaches to me.
Can we please kneel or take a position of prayer? Dear kind and heavenly Father, we give you thanks and praise and honor and glory as we come before you right now. We ask that you wash and you cleanse us from any and all sins so that our prayers may be heard. As we draw near to you right now, we ask that you will also draw near to us, because it's not only us standing in the need of prayer, but we come before you standing with those who have suffered under the hands of abusers. Specifically, I want to put before you unmarried and single young men and women who have faced abuse. We know that abuse comes in many forms. It can be physical, verbal, emotional, psychological, and even spiritual. And we ask that you will surround these victims and that you comfort them. Show them your love in unexpected ways and bring them your comfort. God, some of them may be confused, may be hurt, brokenhearted. They may be feeling the weight of the abuse on their hearts and on their shoulders. Others may even be unaware, having suffered through repeated cycles of abuse. We ask, first of all, that you bring them your peace, and that you bring them strength, the kind that only comes from you. You have promised that you will be near to the brokenhearted and that you will bring rest to those who labor and are weary. Remind them that they are not weak, that they're not deserving of the treatment that they're receiving, and they are not abandoned by you, but they are seen, they are known, and they are loved. Guide them to a place where they can see a way out and bring them out of their situations. Protect them and let them seek and find their hope in you as their deliverer. God, help us to be patient with them. Guide us so that we work with them in accordance with your grace and in accordance with their needs. I pray also for the people who perpetuate abuse. Many of them come from places of abuse themselves. Some of them are unaware that they're abusers, gaslighters, or even perpetuators of fear. Guide us, and as you deal with them justly, keeping in mind their acts, but also their needs, in time, give us and their victims the grace to forgive them. But cause them to be aware of their actions so that they can repent and change their ways. Most of all, let your mercy, your love, and your grace come upon all. And cover us with your love. Hear the prayers of those who seek you, and please come through for those who need you. In Jesus' name, we put all these things and all these people before you. Amen.
Please continue in a state of prayerfulness, because I'm going to be praying for women and children who are living in abusive situations. And as I pray, I'm asking you to lift up your hearts to God. Anyone you know who may be going through sad experiences, lift them up at this time to the Lord. Before we pray, I'm going to read Psalm 145. I'm going to read assurance from our God. Verse 14 says, "The Lord upholds all who fall, and he raises up all those who are bowed down. The Lord is near to all who call upon him, to all who call upon him in truth. He will fulfill the desires of those who fear him. He also will hear the cry of his children, and he will save them." Let us pray. Our Father, O God, mighty and awesome and powerful, you who sit on the throne of heaven, and the Bible says your eyes go to and fro upon the earth, nothing escapes your vision. Even the sparrow that falls from the trees, your eyes see them. And you have told us in your word that your children are far more valued to you than many sparrows. This morning we bring before you women and children, or nationally, internationally, even within our church setting, who find themselves living in abusive situations of all kinds. So oftentimes, the people who promise to love them and care for them are the ones who are abusing them. So many times, they're traumatized. They can't see a way out. Sometimes they're praying and they don't seem to be having answer. Mighty God, everlasting Father, Prince of Peace, Jesus, you who came and walked this earth, who had love and compassion for those that wander about like sheep without shepherd. As we lift up our hearts to you this day, hear our prayers. Wherever these your children are, they're women who have been left to care for children. They have no money, they have no resources which to look after them. They don't even know how to find food. Their hearts are burdened down. I pray that you will enter their situation this morning. I pray you will open up your hands and satisfy the desire of these your children. I pray that you will be especially close to them and let them know their identities in you. And when everybody else rejects and forsakes them, they have a God who loves them beyond all measure. And in your time, you will bring deliverance to these your children. Lord, remember young children and even youths in many of them in these situations, fearing for what they see happening in their homes. Sometimes they're so traumatized they can't even talk about it. They go to sleep and they cry themselves to sleep. Mighty God, I pray that wherever these children are, wherever your people are who are suffering these kind of abuse, I pray you will step down into their situation. I pray, God, that you will send help from above. I pray that you will empower women and children to seek help. And I pray that the people you send them to will have hearts that are kind and compassionate. You will give them wisdom and understanding about these situations and how to deal with them. I pray, God, that you will send mentors to guide and to direct, and to walk alongside with many of these traumatized women and their children. I pray, Father God, that you will give each one finding themselves in this situation strength, your strength, to endure. I pray that you will remind them in your word where you say you keep track of their wanderings. Every tear they shed, you collect them in your bottle. And you keep a record of them. They're in heaven. You are seeing what is happening to them. So I pray as you give guidance and direction to these your children, you will restore them. You will give them strength to know that this too will pass, for they serve a God who really loves and cares for them. And one day you will bring an end to their suffering. I pray you will provide everything they need. I pray you will protect them from the harms and the dangers they encounter. And I pray you will speak to the perpetrators in a really special way. When they lie in their beds at night, Holy Spirit, may you remind them that these are your children made in your image and they have a responsibility to love and care for them. Turn their hearts around. Take away all the anger, the wrath, the bitterness, things that make perpetrators themselves who are hurt and abused do, you know, wicked things to those in their circle. Lord, have mercy. Have mercy upon these your children, upon the perpetrators, upon women, the children, everyone in these abusive situations. May you cover them under the shadow of your almighty wings. Be their refuge until all of these calamities are past and they find themselves secure in your kingdom. This we pray in the name of Jesus and in the power of your might. Have your way and let your children's hearts be comforted, knowing they serve a God who will neither fail them nor abandon them. We pray this prayer in the precious name of Jesus with thanksgiving. Amen.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. Did you hear that? Because I didn't. Good morning, everyone. Let's do that again. Okay. Well, to get that set up, how was everyone's week? Thumbs up. Who had a good week this week? Thumbs up. Okay, quite a few grown-ups get involved as well, so thumbs up for good weeks. Okay. Who had a so-so week? So thumbs in the middle if you had a so-so week. Thumbs in the middle. Grown-ups getting involved. Okay. And who had a horrible week? Thumbs down. Horrible weeks. No, okay, only one person. Okay. All right, so today we're going to be doing a children's story, which is around the topic of End It Now, which is a theme for today, okay? Now, this theme of End It Now, is it not able to get it up? Is it working? Okay, just one second. Let's have a chit-chat whilst the presentation's coming up. End It Now. Let's talk about this. Yes, here we go. Yes, so the theme for today is around End It Now, which links to the topic of abuse. Now, have any of you heard of the word abuse before? Okay, don't look at the screen just yet. What is your understanding of the word abuse? Just ignore the screen. What do you understand it to mean? Anyone? Daniel?
Harm?
Brilliant.
Pain.
Excellent. Anyone here? What do you understand?
Unhappy.
These are excellent words that are all linked to how abuse make us feel or how it can make someone feel. So a definition is to cause someone harm or pain, okay? So it's not a good thing to experience or to give to someone else or to make somebody else experience, okay? Next slide. So in terms of abuse, there are several types, and I don't know if you heard Intia mention some in her prayer. There's quite a few different types of abuse, but just before we get into the object lesson, there's physical abuse. Who can guess what physical abuse is? What is physical abuse?
Punching.
That's one example. So it's physical.
Annoying
someone. Yeah, you can annoy someone by physically abusing. Yeah, that's
hitting.
Hitting, absolutely. So it's a physical form of either inflicting physical pain.
Biting,
yes. These are all, yes.
Not very good,
absolutely. Oh, everyone's talking.
Verbal.
Oh, we're coming on to that one. So excellent answers, everyone. The next one is verbal. As if it just said, it's when you say things, you use your words to cause pain or harm, which we're going to be focusing on today. And finally, emotional, where it's you do things or you say things that you know can change the way someone feels, or you control the way they feel by what you say or what you do. Okay, next slide. Now, a type of abuse which you don't always recognize is actually a form of abuse is bullying. Bullying, if you look at the description of bullying, causing pain or causing harm to someone, this is exactly what bullying is. Now, we have different types of bullying. You've got verbal, whether it could be cyberbullying, online, you might say things to people on social media, on WhatsApp, for example, saying unkind things, or Instagram or Facebook. You've got physical bullying, where it's literally hitting, or as we discussed before. Now, let's get into the type of bullying, as I mentioned, we're going to focus on, which is verbal, okay? Now, for this one, I need two volunteers. So who would like to be my volunteer? Hand shot right up, and one on this side. Yes, you come. Yep. Yes, come on up. We've got, I'll ask some more volunteers afterwards as well, okay? Okay, so I want either of you to stand on each side. The next one, you can come and help me talk, okay? So you can help me talk, and just let everyone know your name.
Joshua.
Say hi, Joshua.
Asha.
Say hi, everyone. Hi, Asha, everyone. Okay, fantastic. So the key text that we're going to look at is from Proverbs chapter 18, verse 21. Now, let's all read it together on the count of three. One, and grown-ups, you can join in as well. One, two, three. What you say can mean life or death. Those who speak will care will be rewarded. Okay, now that sounds a bit dramatic. At first you think what you say can cause life or death. That's a bit dramatic, but let's put that to the test and let's see if the words we say can truly cause life or death, okay? So we have two apples. What do we have? two apples. Boys, come around to this side so you can see the experiment. Okay? And we are going to give these two apples two different sets of treatment. Okay? We have Ash's apple, which we're going to say kind things to. And then we have Joshua's apple, which we're going to say mean, horrible things to. So I need your help, okay, to come up with some statements. So Ash's apple, you can hold your apple. For every kind statement, Ash, you're going to nicely put your apple down and pick it back up. Joshua, for your apple, you're going to drop it, not smash it, drop it from like this level, and then we'll see the difference between them at the end, okay? So who's first up? What's the first kind thing we can say to Ash's apple? He's up. You've got a kind thing we can say to Ash's apple?
I like your hair.
Okay, I like your hair. Okay, so let's calmly put down Ash's apple. Nice. Okay, come. You got to come a bit closer. I'm a bit trapped behind here. Let's say, what's one unkind thing we can say to Joshua's apple?
It's ugly.
Oh, no. The apple's ugly. Drop the apple. Oh, no. Okay, okay. One more kind. What kind thing can we say to Ash's apple?
Your apple looks beautiful.
Your apple looks beautiful. So let's nicely put the apple down. Okay, brilliant, brilliant. We're going to say something to Joshua's apple.
It's stupid.
Oh, no, the apple is stupid. Ah! Oh, okay, okay, okay. You guys are putting your hands up a lot quicker for the Joshua. Okay, one more nice thing for Ash's apple. Who haven't I heard? One of the girls at the back, I haven't heard from you guys today. One kind thing we can say to Ash's apple.
Your apple is very colourful.
Your apple is very colourful. Calmly put the apple down, okay? Nice. Okay, one more unkind thing we can say to Joshua's apple.
Your apple is musty and crusty.
Your apple is musty and crusty. Ah, okay, okay, okay. So we've treated these apples very differently. Can someone hold the mic for me? Hold it so I can speak. From a distance, can you see any difference between the two apples here?
No, not really.
No, they look exactly, from the outside growing up, from where you are, they look exactly the same, as though nothing has happened to them. We'll come, but we're gonna put these apples. And we're going to come back to them, okay? We're going to come back to the apples, all right? Back to the presentation. Everyone, take a seat. We're going to come back to the apples and see. Let's let them marinate a little bit, okay? So the next slide. Okay, so we've put this to the test. The other test that I've got for you is, it's just a challenge, all right? It's using something called toothpaste, okay? Everyone uses toothpaste, I hope, right? Wait, I didn't hear you say yes. Everyone uses toothpaste, right? Okay, okay. So, in the same way, the text we read before, it says our words can either bring life and death. But the thing about your words, when you speak your words, can you take it back? Yeah. Let's try. So everyone say hello and try to catch the word and put it back in your mouth. Let's do that. So one, two, three. Hello. Hello. Did you take it back? Hello. No, exactly. The words we speak, as I'm going to demonstrate with the toothpaste, every single word we speak, it comes out. It comes out, all the way out. But let's really test this. I want a volunteer who's up for a challenge. Okay, so who haven't I heard from today? I did promise you actually from the last round. So if you come, we're gonna count from 10 to 0, and let everyone know your name.
Amaya Zuri.
Say hi, Amaya Zuri. Okay, and so what Amaya Zuri's challenge is, and then if she's not successful, you will have a go as well, okay? You have 10 seconds to try to get the toothpaste back into the container, okay? You think you could do it? You think, yes, confidence, we love it. Okay, so everyone, we're gonna count from 10. Here's the spoon, if you need a spoon. Let's count from 10, through three. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Okay. How did she do? Has she gotten the toothpaste back in? No. Okay. Would you like to have a go? To let everyone know your name.
My name is Daniel.
Daniel. Okay. Daniel's going to have a go. Well done, Amaya Zuri. Again, we're going to count from 10, 2, 3. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Is the toothpaste back in the container?
Yes.
We can have a few more tries later for time. And that's exactly what it is. Everyone's listening? That's exactly what it's like with our words, which is why it's so important, as this text in Proverbs chapter 18, verse 21 says. We'll read this one together as well. Grown-ups, get involved. 2, 3. It says, a kind answer soothes angry feelings, but harsh words stir them up. So it's super important. The Bible lets us know that our words are powerful. It can bring life. That could be emotional life. You could damage someone. And we'll come to our apples in a minute. But they also, a kind answer can also calm a situation as opposed to making it worse. Now, let's get back to our apples. Let's cut them wide open. And let's see what our apples look like. So everyone come up. Okay, so can anyone tell me which ones are bad apple and our good apple? Can you tell? You can't tell, which is similar. Your words, you may not always see on the outside the impact your words can have on someone. But let's see how the inside might look, okay? So can you hold the mic for me?
You're
going to
cut it open.
Can I cut it open? And I'll use the knife. So this. Okay. So this is our good apple, which looks good, right?
Yeah.
This is one we said lots of kind words to. Let's look at our bad apple. It's all brown and dirty on the inside. And similarly, no, our brown skin is beautiful, okay? Don't get the two confused, okay? So, literally, our words have that same impact. If you say horrible things to each other, or even to yourself, on the outside you might think, oh, they're fine, they can handle it. But actually, you're hurting and damaging yourself or the people around you, okay? So whenever you're speaking to your friends and to yourself, speak kind words to yourself, but not just because it's a good thing to do. The Bible makes it very clear that our words are powerful, okay? So now, next slide. Just to wrap us up, I have two challenges for you this week. How many challenges do I have for you this week?
Two.
The first challenge is use your words for good. Look for opportunities where you can speak up for someone who perhaps may not know how to use their words. There's a text in Psalms I can't remember that God says that we are to speak up for those who are voiceless. So this week, use your words for what? Use your words for what?
Good.
Good. And the second thing, each day, starting from today, I want all of you to find one person at least to say something kind to. So when you go back to your seats, look around the church. It could be your friends, kind things only. And find someone you want to say something kind to today, this week, okay? Okay?
Yeah.
Okay, fabulous. So that's it for today's children's story. I hope you all learned something today. You do? Well, someone said that it doesn't have a friend. So are we all going to make a friend to Daniel today?
Yes.
Absolutely. So there's plenty of opportunity here. Everyone has agreed to be friends with you or to make friends with you today. Okay? Does that make you feel a bit better? Amazing. Okay, so make sure you reach out to Daniel today, guys. So that's it. We're going to say a word of prayer. Now, I need two volunteers. Who would like to pray for us? Okay, so who haven't I heard from today? I want someone who I haven't heard speak today. So, come on up, eye contact. You made eye contact, so I have one volunteer there. The key is not to make eye contact. And then we'll have Amara. Come on up. So both of you, come on up. It's a privilege to pray. A one-liner. We'll take a one-liner prayer from you. Thank you so much, Devani. All right, so come on up. Alara, you can go first. Let's get in a posture of prayer.
Let us pray. Dear Lord and Heavenly Father, thank you for waking us up this morning. Thank you for a nice Sabbath day and a nice children's story. Please bless us through the new week. Thank you for what you've done for us. Thank you for hearing and answering prayers. In your mighty name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Let's pray. Dear God, thank you for waking us up this morning. And please help us to have a good day today. And please help us to worship you and to pray for our problems. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Beautiful. beautiful prayers. Thank you all. Back to your seats. Thank you.
Again, church. So we are your praise team for this Sabbath. We're going to introduce ourselves briefly. So my name is Rumbi.
Naomi. Tamia. Abigail. Insia.
And Serena.
And I have a text for you before we begin today. It's actually my favorite text. It's taken from Lamentations 3, verse 22 and 23. It says, "Through the Lord's mercies, we are not consumed, because his compassions fail not. They are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness." And I guess based on this text, and I was listening to What a Friend We Have in Jesus, all our sins and griefs to bear, what a privilege it is to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear, all because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. So I think based on those two things that I've been thinking about, I invite you all not to rob yourself of the joy and the peace that God offers you today, and bask in worshiping him with us. Now the slides, the music, is acting up. So I will do my best to call out the words, but I don't know if I'll be as succinct. Also because of that, since we have Google, and most of you, I assume, have a phone, I'll let you know what the songs we'll be singing today are in order. So the first song will be Higher Ground, number 625. The second, God Is. The third, Waymaker. And the fourth, Goodness of God. So I'll announce them as we go on, but if you want to Google the lyrics, just in case this is acting up again, then that's what we'll do. So the first song is number 625, Higher Ground.
Still praying hands on onward.
once again. Lord, lift me up.
Lord, lift me up, and I shall stand by faith on heaven's table land. A higher plane that I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground.
Amen. God is.
Stay in the narrow way,
keep my life clean.
next song is Waymaker. Start with You Are Here. Together. Amen.
You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are.
Amen. And the last song we will sing is Goodness of God. Thank you. love you.
I love you, Lord, for your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
That's from the top. I love you.
I love you, Lord, for your mercy never fails me, and all my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness. Is running after me.
voices all my life together.
And all my life you have been faithful.
Let's sing, God, church.
And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Amen.
Happy Sabbath, church. Today's scripture reading is Psalms 32, verse 5 to 12. Psalm 30. For his anger endureth but a moment, in his favor is life. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy cometh in the morning. And in my prosperity I said, I shall never be moved. Lord, by thy favor thou hast made my mountain to stand strong. Thou didst hide thy face, and I was troubled. I cried to thee, O Lord, and unto the Lord I made supplication. What profit is there in my blood when I go down to the pit? Shall the dust praise thee? Shall it declare thy truth? Hear, O Lord, and have mercy upon me. Lord, be thou my helper. Thou hast turned for me my mourning into dancing. Thou hast put off my sackcloth and girded me with gladness, to the end that my glory may sing praise to thee, and not be silent. O Lord my God, I will give thanks unto thee forever. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of his holy word.
Happy Sabbath, church. Happy Sabbath. I know they say we shouldn't keep saying it. You've had that greeting many times, but I can't help, because it really is a happy Sabbath. And as we sang Goodness of God, and I could see people singing that song personally, isn't it awesome when God can inspire you with a word? And that's how we're praying, that our speaker will be inspired with a word, because I know she's an inspired woman. And words are powerful. We learned that in our children's story. So we're glad to be here. It's a blessed Sabbath for many reasons. One of the reasons it's a blessed Sabbath is because our beloved Pastor Hannah has recovered. The devil tried to take her out. God said, no, she's my daughter. And you'll see her at the back. No cameras, please. But you'll see her at the back looking very well, smiling. She is here. She's open to hugs and kisses, I believe, at the appropriate time. Okay, so welcome back to our pastor, Hannah. We're glad to have you. More good news. Our church is getting ready for end times. How do I know? We've got conference session coming up. And in addition to all of the administrative planning, our leaders have said, you know what, it's not enough just to plan for this with human hands. They've said, we need to go into prayer, because these are serious times and we want God to put our package together. We don't want God to choose our person because we like them or because they're from our country or because they tend to give our church funding. We want God to choose our team because he knows they will fulfill his purpose. And so we're excited to announce that our SEC, under the leadership of Pastor Osei, has arranged for us to have a prayer meeting, a special prayer meeting this week. I believe it says at 7, the writing seems to say 7:10, 7:30. Does anyone want to clarify? 7 to 10, sorry. So that's a long prayer meeting. We really got blessings in store. So 7 o'clock. I believe there's going to be some Zoom details, or maybe it will be on the SEC media. Zoom details are coming. So let's look out for that. So I understand they're saying, don't do your regular church prayer meeting. Let's come together, because if my people humble themselves and pray and turn from their wicked way and seek my face, I might be saying it in the wrong order, but what does God say he will do? He will hear and he will heal. Enough said. Anyway, I am joyfully here. You might wonder why I'm talking so much, but I want to say to the speaker that it's partly your fault. You see, I was youth in this church not so long ago, you know, just a few years ago, when she was a youth leader as a pastor's wife. So I'm talking about our speaker today, Sister Laura Osei. And I want to just say welcome home to her, because actually this was a church. I'm sure you brought your membership here. and we managed to hold the Osei family for a long time, but they were impactful in this church. In fact, can I say that it was some of our glory days in this church. Sister Osei was one of those pastor's wives that weren't satisfied just to look pretty and sing occasionally. She got her hands involved in everything, and it was a good work. I can remember many things. How many of you remember the song she taught us, one AYS? I'm up on the mountain, out in the ocean, down in the valley. Why don't you? All right. Things like that we got from her. I remember many dynamic youth programs. I remember going on youth retreat. And in fact, there's a scripture that I can remember. Why do I remember it? Because she was teaching us about the internalization of God's word. And it was, be anxious for nothing. I still remember that Sabbath you taught us. And I've needed to use that many times. So sorry for making it a bit personal, but sometimes you need to do that. She's a lady who God has loaded with a lot of stuff. And while we're talking about end now, I want to take a little opportunity to pay tribute to Pastor Osei in his absence, because if you want to see a man who's doing a good job, he's not a perfect man, but when you see a wife who is empowered, you know that she's been given space and support to be empowered. And so if you want a wife that still looks young in years to come and who can represent you, yeah, look after her. That's the message, isn't it? Even if you make mistakes, God will make up the shortfall. So I wanted to just share that word and say thank you for the investment you made in my youth. God bless you, and to many in this church. And so I will go on to some more formal elements. Sister Laura Osei is the head teacher of the Eden SDA School, a Christian faith school in West London, where the school motto is educating for eternity. She has been an English teacher for the past 45 years. She was even a careers teacher at John Loughborough when I was there. And a head teacher for 28 years. She enjoys public speaking, reading books, writing plays, books and songs, researching the Black Hebrews, and plays the guitar. Laura is passionate about Christian education and recognizes that she is called by God to sound the loud cry for Christian teachers and eventually finding salvation by giving their lives to Christ. Mrs. Laura Osei is the wife of Pastor Emmanuel Osei, who I just spoke about, who is the president of the South England Conference. She is also the mother of three beautiful adult daughters, Naomi Adoma, a professional speaker and business consultant, Danielle Akosa, a medical doctor, and Leah Ajua Mansa, a barrister. Have you noticed that none of those surnames were Osei? So we're giving thanks, church, because we remember all of those girls growing up here. They're all married women. They've chosen to marry. Isn't that a blessing? And God has granted. It sounds like they've all gone back home as well, because none of those names sound English. So we know that Dad's Ghanaian influence has been felt. We thank God for these daughters. And I have to say, in terms of mothering, we've seen Sister Osei love her children. And we know we've got many such mothers in the church. Now, her family is blessed with three adorable grandchildren, Rianne Abina, aged 11 years, Aaron Kwabena, aged 9 years, Micah, who is 17 months. Her mantra is, to God be the glory, great things he has done. Now, I just want to acknowledge, I know that this lady has some support, and you've got her support chorus. Can I just ask you all to stand? Because I know you're here because you love your sister. So we just want to acknowledge your people today who are here. You too. Thank you for coming. And I also want to just take the opportunity to acknowledge Yvette and say we're glad to have you in the house of God. So at this time, you will hear a musical piece. And after that, the next verse, the voice you will hear will be that of Sister Laura Osei. God bless you.
we will now be doing a special item. I just can't give up now. There'll be two solos from your Holloway children. And I must say that encouragement is a good thing. Came from the platform, but also from you. So we will sing, I Just Can't Give Up Now.
I've come up with my tissue, and I blame Anel for that. Because, oh dear, it's going to be bad, this. Please forgive me. I had so many wonderful experiences here at Holloway that just coming back, I haven't been back in years, and it just brought tears to my eyes when Anel began talking about all the things that we used to do. It's not about me, but it's what we used to do. And I've always said that please, if you're from another church, take this with a pinch of salt. But I've always said that Holloway's my church. You don't see me much, but there's just something about it. I don't know what, but and the mere fact that, you know, when Annelle spoke, I just had to just try and control myself, told me that it is true. There is something special about this church, and I'm moved. Thank you for inviting me. It's lovely to see all the wonderful faces. I'm not going to say old faces, because I'll be talking about myself as well. And it's wonderful to see children who were really little. And then now I can tell, I don't know their names, but I know which family they come from. And you know, because the genes are just so strong. And even the ones singing, I just remember them as little toddlers. And now, they're up here singing confidently. And I praise God for Holloway Church. My husband loved his time here as well. My children adored it. And we had the greatest fun here. And I just want to thank the older folks who supported the church to make it possible for young people to still be in the church and to still love the Lord. My husband sends his greetings, and he's preaching, I believe, in Romford. Usually I'm with him, but today, or he's with me, but today we're separated. I prefer that, actually, because I don't like preaching when he's there, because I think he's taking notes and saying, too many windows, not enough bricks, and that's what he does. I'm happy. And he also told me, don't go over the top. Yeah, he warned me. And he said, and don't preach about the black Hebrews. That's what he told me. What a cheek. And I thought, okay, I don't tell you what to preach when you're going to Romford. But nevertheless, I'm going to try and follow his direction. I'd like to thank my sister Angela and her daughter, my niece, Laverne, and a member from Hanworth Church. The three of them have come to support me today, and I just want to thank them for joining us. God bless. I was meant to bring a lot more, but you know what? Life is hard, yeah? Life isn't easy. It's not perfect, and we go through lots and lots of challenges, and you see us in church with our hats and our smart clothes and our high heels. By the way, Anil, I loved your heels. And your kente. Okay, let's get back to things. And you know, we look good on the outside, but nobody knows what's going on in there. And that's why we can't judge, because some of us are carrying a lot of burden. Some of us are carrying a lot of grief. Some of us have lost people we've loved dearly. And yet we come to church and we smile. And I just wanted to just remind people that if God ever looks down and laughs, he's saying, look how stressed she is. Look how stressed he is. If only they knew that that thing that's destroying them will turn out to be something great or insignificant. And I had to take that. Someone sent that to me, so that's why I have my phone. Someone sent that to me, and it made such a difference because I was going through things. And when I had that, I just said, yes, God, I'll laugh with you. You know, and truly, weeping may for the night. But praise God, joy comes in the morning. Praise God, joy comes in the morning. And we praise God for that in so many ways. Right, let me see if I can work this, Hubert. I'm going to point in there. Yes, the theme is End It Now. New beginnings, your joy is coming. And truly, our joy is coming. We don't realize it, but our joy is on its way in so many ways. But because we're blocked, Or we're very narrow in what we see. We only see the weeping, and we only see the pain, but truly joy comes in the morning. And that's our focus for today. The theme that's been an emphasis for today is abuse of power. End it now. And the Adventists say no to violence. And let's pray. Dear Father, we're just so proud to be in your presence today. And Lord, we just want to thank you that your spirit is in this place and that Holloway is still a refuge and a haven for people to come and find the Lord, for people to come and find peace and contentment, for people to find comfort. So bless us now as we begin your words, not mine, but your words. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I want to start by showing us something. I hope I'm doing this right. It's not happening. Talk to me, Hubert. What have I done that's wrong? Right. I'm going to be doing this all the time. I'm not used to these technical things. Is this good or bad, what you're seeing up there? Somebody said bad. Bad? Someone said it depends. And someone else said it depends on how you use it. Yes? Now let's look at the problems we go through. Think about your own problem. Is it good or bad? Tell me. Good or bad? It depends. It depends on what? How you see it. So I'm going through a challenge. You're going through a challenge. Is it good or bad? For us, it's always going to be bad. I'm sorry. I haven't reached to that elevated stage where I could say, it's good. No. It's bad. But it's what lens I'm using. And the lens God wants us to use is to say it is good. Because what all things? To them. Amen. So when we are going through a challenge, when we're going through a difficulty, don't know if you will be able to say it. As I said, I'm not there yet. But we need to recognize that all things work together for our good. It may seem messy, and it may seem challenging, and it may take years, and it may take a lifetime. But good and joy comes in the morning. Oh, gosh, I'm going to keep going. I'm sure I'm just going the wrong way. Right, one more. Right, I think I'll get it right now. Ever since Adam and Eve ate that fruit, husbands and wives have been under attack. Yes? Adam was blaming, and Eve was blaming. Not working together, fighting. That's where the first fight came about between husbands and wives. And yet she was the most beautiful, gorgeous woman that Adam had ever seen. And he was the most strong and elegant and muscular man that Eve had ever seen. But nevertheless, there were tears. Nevertheless, there were problems. We are under attack. The attack led to the family being under attack, which led to Cain killing Abel. So what's happening in the home with the mother and the father affects the children. Yes, are we in agreement? And the sad thing is that it affects the children for generations. It's not just affecting those children that you've birthed, but it could be the grandchildren and then the great-grandchildren. There is an attack on our family. There is an attack on our husbands and an attack on our wives and an attack on our children. But instead of us dealing with the attacker, who do we fight? Each other. And it's such a sad, sad shame. We hurt and abuse each other. There's been lots of abuse of power in the Bible. I'm not going to go through them very, very deeply, but just to say Lucifer, he was the most powerful angel in heaven. And he lost his power because he abused his power. Are we in agreement? And he became known as Satan Pharaoh abused you. He was the greatest king on the earth at the time, and he abused his power and thought that he could mess with our God. And he lost his power. He lost his son, the heir to the throne, and he lost his fame and glory. And it says historically that after the children of Israel left Egypt, Egypt was attacked and ransacked and brutalized by many other nations because they saw they weren't so powerful after all. Eli's sons, sad to say, that bit always worries me, because when you have a leader, you would automatically assume that the leader's children will be just as great, just as honest, just as fair, just as loving. But sadly, Eli's sons weren't, and they caused his death. You know, it was just too much for him to bear. So we have to recognize that what we do with our children, or what we do in our lives, can affect our generations. And even the children of Israel, and when I say the children of Israel, even though my husband told me not to, I'm talking about yourselves, okay? Because you are the Hebrews. I don't know how many people are aware of that. I'm not just talking about the Caribbeans. I'm talking about the Africans, and I'm talking about the Asians. I'm talking about the Brazilians. We are, and so on. There's so many more. I'm not going to go for every single country. But we are the original Hebrews. So when you go down to Stamford Hill, and you see the Hebrews, the Jews walking, and you think, wow, they were the chosen. No, no, no. We are the chosen people. Don't get it twisted. Now, a lot of us don't believe it. Oh, we are the chosen people. Why do you think so many of us are in church today? Look around the world. Why are there so many of us worshiping? Because that was in our genes. Yes? And it was stolen. So the Jews you see in Stamford Hill, sorry if my husband's ever hearing this, the Jews you see in Stamford Hill, they converted. Do you understand that? They converted to Judaism because they had to make a choice between choosing Catholicism, Islam, or Judaism, or get killed. And they chose to follow the Jews because they liked the Jewish faith the most. Plus, the Jews were the richest. I bet you can't believe it now with us, isn't it? But I'm telling you, it's in our genes. It's in our genes. And so with this, with the Jews, remember the Jews, they came from Europe. Come on, people, they came from Europe. That's why their skin is a different color to yours. The Hebrews, look at Paul was called an Ethiopian. Do you remember? Why? Because he had a dark skin like yours. Yes, he was very short as well, I gather. So I wonder if he was my relative, you know. And I would love to be able to find out. I've been asking God, God, which tribe did I come from? But anyway, it's all right. We'll find out when we get to heaven. Let's go on. I'm not going to even go to King. King David abused his power. How did he abuse it? Bathsheba. He saw a lovely female having a bath. And he allowed his passion, yes, to get the better of him. Lost his power. And he suffered because his son died. And then it goes on, because if you read through the generations of, am I going the wrong way again? The generations of kings after him, they were just going down and down and down. Yeah, Josiah came up. Manasseh went right down and then popped up at the end. Fancy that, Manasseh's going to be in heaven. I'm very upset about that. Very upset. But anyhow, God, thank God that God is God and not me, because he would not come. Praise God. Demons, I must rush on because it's called two. Demons have waged war on humans from the beginning of time. Yeah? They just hate us. Why do they hate us? That's right. That's right. They've lost out. They can't have what we can have, and we will replace the demons. So that's why their only goal, through harassment, through child abuse, through bullying, through blackmail, bribery, shame, domination, molestation, emotional or physical abuse, sexual, I don't know why I put a C in there, please forgive me, I am an English teacher, I can spell, I don't know what happened there. Sexual abuse, I know my niece is laughing her head off because I used to teach her English, and she's thinking, wow, Mrs. Osei, how could you do that? Okay, let's move on, I'm really trying to go fast because I'd like you lot to have lunch before 5 o'clock. And there's positional power. People in authority love to wield power. Yes? The head elder struts around like the king. The head deaconess, her hat is the biggest. Because, you know, we love power. All of these people there. We love to rule over others. But God wants a humble person. Yes? He also said, don't give the youth too much power. It'll get to their head. So I really learned that as a child. I just heard about it somewhere in church, at Chiswick Church growing up, that when young people are given a lot of power because they have special gifts, they can lose everything because the power goes to their head. And I always used to pray, Lord, keep me humble. Keep me humble, because it's easy to show off and it's easy to strut around and cut style. God wants a humble and contrite heart. And so we need to ask for it. If we haven't got it, and I know I didn't have it, and I'm always praying about it, because it's easy. When people praise you, it's easy to think, oh, I did this on my own. No, if not for God, you would be nowhere. Let's go on. I'm going to really speed on. There's other types of abuse of power. Economic. You know, husband, I'm saying to my husband, Emmanuel, please, I've run out of money, give me £200. What do you want it for? I mean, why would you ask me? Excuse me, when we got married, we became one. Your money's my money, and my money's mine, you know? So, economic power. I saw Dean like that very much. He would still give me, but he's grumbling all the way through. Influence. There are some people who have great influence, and it can be used for glory and praising God, or it can be used for damnation. So we have to be careful. If we influence a group, and young people, I'm talking to you, if you influence a group in your class or in college, influence them for good. Don't, because when you influence them for evil, you are causing the destruction or the damnation of people maybe for hundreds of years to come. You know, so think before you do something, because your action can affect somebody in great ways. And it can be either for them to know the Lord, for them to run as far from Jesus as possible. So just bear that in mind. Physical, informational, psychological, emotional, spiritual, and sexual. The informational one, I found that one a bit odd. Could someone tell me, what does that mean? How could you abuse with information? Gosh, say that again, withholding? Yes. Oh, thank you, Anel. I should have had you help me write this, because you got that spot. I was thinking, if I can't work on that one, let's pass on. You know, but thank you, Anel is here. Praise God for her brain. Yes, information, a really great one. Sexual, I mean, that's obvious. Yeah, we don't have to talk about psychological. Oh, that can happen in the home easily. That can happen with colleagues and friends. So we really have to remember, you know, I think we have to remember as people that each one of us here, we're related in some way. You know, we're relatives, you know. We're not just separate families. We all had the same mom and dad originally. And that mom and dad, the person sitting next to you, that's the same mom and dad. So shouldn't we treat them with care? Shouldn't we treat them with respect? The same way we will fight for our families, we should be fighting for them. So it's really, really important. I'm going to rush on again. There's been lots of stories in the press and by word of mouth about the abuse of power, yes? And you've heard in the Catholic Church with the priests and how they're abusing the boys. Sad to say, even in the Adventist Church, you've heard of leaders abusing children, and in all of the churches. And it's not so much that the church is wicked and evil and bad, but it's the fact that Lucifer hates us, and he will do everything in his power to cause us to suffer, to sin, you know, and we're all sinners. You know, don't think for a minute this one's a sinner over there, but we're all sinners. And it's only by God's grace that we are saved. So it's you know, let's just recognize that our church isn't perfect. And when we point at other churches, there's a thumb pointing back at ours. Remember that. See if I can go. More suffering. Because of the attacks of the enemy, we suffer. We suffer with rejection. We suffer with jealousy, with guilt, with criticism, with sadness, with unfulfillment, with pain of growing children, and that one is a hard one. Fear of losing children. Yeah, just, you know, when they leave home, what's going to happen to them? Will they come back at the end of the day? You know, divorce. The divorce, I can't believe how much in our church we have divorce. I find that really strange. Just because I believe, in all honesty, that what God has put together, let no man put asunder. And I think I hate it most when I hear of pastors getting divorced. I think, well, then how could you even help your members if you couldn't go to God and get God to help you with this one? I think divorce is a no, 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 no. Okay, it does happen. And the same way I look down on it, I know that I'm a sinner. And I haven't lived and I haven't walked in the shoes of those who are suffering. Because there is a time, you know, especially with abuse, where wives may have to do so, and where husbands may have to, because you know wives do abuse husbands as well, yeah? You know, we're always talking about the women, but the men get blows just as much, and they have to go into, what's those homes, Angela? Refuge, you know, because of that, you know? So let's remember, There is a time, because even God has allowed it. You know, he has said there is, you know, when we read it in the New Testament with Paul, you know, Paul's explanation that there is a place for it. I just have a thing about it. Cancer, more suffering. And you know, the bit about cancer that bothers me the most is the fact that a lot of our people didn't have to die of cancer. Yeah? A lot of our people didn't have to die of cancer. And cancer, for our color people, is because we're not having enough sun, yeah? And so we're not getting enough of the vitamin D. And that is what, our body then becomes very, very weak and open to attacks from anything around us. Stress and is also another thing. If you're a stressful person, if you worry, 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 and Anel, your point, you know, if we be not anxious for anything, because that, God knew what he was talking about. It can kill. And what even hurts me the most is the fact that when we go for the treatment, many doctors have said they wouldn't give it to their families. They would not allow their families to take chemo and radiation because they know it may, they will say, oh, it's gone into, what's the word? A remission, and then it comes back after some years. It didn't go into no remission, it went and hid, and it's coming back. You know, so we as a people, we've got the health message. We've got the health message, so we shouldn't be going down the route of this. You know, I know people who have done it, and they've survived it, and I praise God for that, but the majority of people who go down that route, it's negative. It's wrong, and they're damaged for life, you know? So the cancer one always bothers me a lot as well. Let's move on. With all of this attack, how can we survive the attack? What's the one thing we need? Prayer. Because it's now a war, it's a battle, and there's a war going on, and we are in a fight. Can we fight the devil? No, we cannot fight the devil. It's an impossibility. What we need to do is like shadow boxing, yeah? Fighting, and you can't see who you're fighting. The Bible tells us in Ephesians 6:12 that we wrestle not against flesh and blood. So we enlist the support of a spirit to fight the spirit, yes? The evil spirit. And spirit versus spirit is a sure way of winning, because when we're on our knees, the battle is won and the victory is ours. So we praise God for that. The most powerful way to fight spiritually is on our knees. Arguing won't do it. If our husband's getting on our nerves, our children are causing problems, our wives are just nagging nonstop, arguing won't do it. Debating won't do it. Intellectualizing, some of us are very, very gifted, that won't do it. Coercing, trying to force, that's domination, it won't do it. Singing, some of us are beautiful singers, that won't do it. Even though I know when I get my husband really mad, he starts singing, "The Lord will fight for me." Do you know that song? I'll actually, and then I humble myself quickly because I don't want to fight the Lord. I don't want to. Anytime he sings it, I know I've pressed the wrong button. The Lord will, you know that song? Yeah? The Lord, do you know the song? "The Lord will fight for me." And he also told me that foolishly, when he was a younger man, he asked the Lord for patience, and then God gave him me, you know? And I just think, thank you, you know? I said, at least I'm doing a good work. Preaching won't do it. Many preachers have to be preachers because they won't get to heaven any other way, because they're so bad, yeah? So preach, you know, and so God has to give them a role where they just have to preach the word, you know? And that may save them, but that's if they cling on to Jesus. Don't be like little Johnny. His mom was having a baby, and mom and dad, of course, and he said, "Dear Lord, I really want a baby brother. I don't want a baby sister." And so he thought, you know what? God won't really listen to me, because God knows I'm really a bad boy. So he decided, I'll write a letter to God instead. So he wrote, "Dear God, please give me a baby brother." And then he screwed it up and says, "God knows. He just knows I do all naughty things." So he screwed up the paper, chucked it in the bin. And then he had a wonderful idea. His parents were Catholic. He ran to the sitting room, and on the mantelpiece, there was a statue of the Virgin Mary. He grabbed her. He ran to his bathroom, got a towel and wrapped it around the Virgin Mary, put some elastic bands and rope around it. And he got back on his knees and said, "Dear God, if you want to see your mother again," you know? And sometimes we are very much like that. We really want to, we want to force God. "After all I've done for you, God," I've heard that. I've heard even a relative of mine going through difficulty saying, "After all I did for God." And that one was, wow, I just, you know. But sometimes we can't help it. We do think like that. Right, I'm not doing too bad. We're going to finish soon. We must never underestimate the rulers of darkness and the spiritual host. Don't play with them. They've been around, you know, for thousands of years. And before that, we don't even know, maybe millions, I don't know. You know, beyond, you know, in heaven and beyond. They were around long before us. They knew God face to face. They worshiped God. They were given mighty powers. That's why they could do all kind of manner of evil. Yet we're told, hey, they might have the power. But all power is given unto us through Christ, Matthew 28. That means we have power at our disposal. We have power in our fingertips. No weapon formed against us can prosper. Hallelujah. We just have to ensure we have the right tools. So what are the right tools? Take up the whole armor of God and you'll find the right tools. You need to be armed for victory. On your knees, remember. So you stand having girded your waist with truth. The Roman soldier, when about to fight, would tie up his tunic with a strong belt so that it wouldn't hamper him or hinder his fight, because his tunic was long. We have to let go of those things which hold us back. Our pet sins, our addictions, our weaknesses that nobody knows but us in our home. You can't do that by yourself. You have to allow the Spirit to do that for you. Put on the breastplate of righteousness. Stay healthy. If you're going to fight and battle with the evil one, you need to stay healthy. We need to pay attention to our health if we're going to war. If our body is racked in pain and weakness, it's hard to stay focused. The food we eat is who we are. Junk food equals a junky mind. To fight the spiritual battle, we need to be healthy. But it doesn't mean some people, God allows them to be unhealthy if they've chosen that path, and they are to pray in their beds, like intercessory prayer for the rest of us. Yeah, so it's like in a battle, some stay in the hospital because they've gotten to hurt, but they must remember those on the battlefield. Sandals of peace, let's go on to that one. Be firm in your belief. The Roman soldier wore sandals made up of sharp nails. Over the most rugged terrain, they had a firm footing. Be consistent. Don't be a silly, wishy-washy Christian. Don't be taken in by fanaticism and be led astray. Hang on to what you believe and keep it simple. Don't get too deeply into, you know, theology. That some people go into theology and they lose out on God altogether. They forget God because they theologized. What's the word? Theologized? Yeah, is that such a word? Yeah? They just bring it to another level. Let's move on from that. Shield of faith. Keep from temptation. Temptation is all around us. We know our weaknesses. Keep from it. And we might find it hard to do it ourselves, but we can call on a spirit who can keep us from temptation. The Roman soldiers how could you hurt them when they're covered like that with their shield of faith? Powerful. The helmet of salvation, keep our minds clear, keep focus. It helps our spiritual strength. God is able to communicate to us directly when our minds are clear. Talk to someone you trust if you're burdened. Share your pain, get help, get counsel. Let the Holy Spirit lead your thoughts. So don't try and think, I can do this on my own. I can fight this battle on my own. You can't. Only with the help of the Holy Spirit and friends and family and leaders that you trust. And that word trust is so important. Let's move on. The sword of the Spirit. Study to show yourselves approved unto God. Workmen that need not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Search the scriptures. We're told it has life. Christ used the scriptures to fight the devil when tempted. This caused the devil to flee. Hold on to the promises of God. God cannot lie. If he's promised it, he will do it. Finally, after all is said and done, then pray. 2 Chronicles 7 verse 14 says, if my people, can you say it with me? If my people are called by my name, shall humble themselves. Okay, I've heard it in all different ways, but I think we've got the point, yeah? If God has called you, and you are his people, his remnant people, and God is calling all. It's not just us as the Hebrew people who will be saved. The Hebrews were given such a work to do, and they messed up completely. Messed up, and that's why in Deuteronomy, it tells us that we will be placed on ships and go to other lands. And we will build houses in these other lands, and other people will dwell in them. And we'll have wives who will be sold to other men. And we'll have children who will be sold. That was all a promise. And the children of Israel, the Hebrew people, said, yes, we understand all that. We will do it. We will accept it. And they accepted it, and here we are today, called by his name. But God calls a remnant people now, not just the Hebrews, a remnant people from all areas around the world, from every culture, from every, I don't believe in race, because it's only one race, the human race. You know, so God says, I will hear, I will heal, I will save. Your joy is coming. Hang on to the Lord. God bless you. Amen. Did I do well with time? Yes? Praise God.
Amen. Can we stand and sing our closing hymn, number 99? God will take care of you. Dismayed.
Be not dismayed, whatever.
God will take care of you.
God will take care of you.
Beneath his wings.
Beneath his wings of love above. God will take care of you. God will take care of you through every day or all the way. He will take care of you. God will take care of you through days of toil when your heart does fail. God will take care of you when dangers.
Thank you, dear Father. That's a promise, and we accept it. Lord, we're going through so many different things, every one of us, Lord, and yet you have time for each one, and you've heard our prayers, and you have answered. And let us leave here with the knowledge that you will take care of us, and you are taking care of us. So we thank you, we praise you, and we glorify your name for this beautiful Sabbath and the blessings you've honored us with and bestowed upon us. And bless us now as we move into the next phase of our service this afternoon. Bless this church. We love the Holloway Church, and we pray anointing upon it in Jesus' name. Amen.
We just want to say thank you again, Sister Osei, for such a marvelous sermon. Thank you very much. Just before we sing the extra, which will be the first verse and chorus of Blessed Assurance, just want to remind you all that lunch is provided, and we do have an afternoon program that will commence at 5 o'clock. There'll be two workshops running simultaneously. One will be by the SEC Children's Director, Judy Clements, which is for children and adults are welcome. And one will be by Sister Ince Greenaway, which will be adults only. Adults only will be in the youth hall. Children and adults will be upstairs. And there'll also be a skit by the youth department. So please do stay. So we're going to sing the extra. Please do sing with us now. The hymn number 462, Blessed Assurance.
Verse 2.
Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending bring from above echoes of mercy, whispers of love.
Have a lovely Sabbath, church, and we'll see you in the afternoon.